everybody. Because of time constraint, because Mr. Erkin has to catch his flight at 1:15, so without taking much time, I have asked him to introduce his late father himself, the journey he has been through all these years leading the Uyghur freedom struggle, and share with us the experience, the wisdom, everything, working with Tibetan people, His Holiness Dalai Lama. So he is someone who has been in this world for many, many years and been in the struggle, been in the trenches. So yesterday we were very pleasantly surprised that he was in town. And even though it was Sunday, Kasha felt it was a great privilege to host him a lunch. So as we were conversing, we felt that he could share the same wisdom and experience with the CTA staff members. So that's why Mr. Erkin is here. That tuzue kengi kuranyatanda namdul suyo thangbul pegu yodoy kabla tuzue ringa diyan kuranran shashe ni kamyo nandine tibetilin samzui jilin nayala kuran gawo yoy sheche sungudu disonza ngi tuzue shira le mogwa che. We all know his late dad was a very prominent leader in the, at that time, the Xinjiang province created by the Kuomintang government. He went on to become the Secretary General of Xinjiang province at that time. And later he had to flee and travel around the world to lead the Uyghur freedom struggle. And obviously, like his great father, the freedom struggle was succeeded by very capable, dedicated son, and throughout these years. And today he is here more as a father to his son who is in Delhi. And then still our struggle is very similar. The pains and the sufferings that we have been through are also very similar. I was just sharing with him, one time in Columbia University, we had a Mongolian, Uyghur, Tibetans, and talking about our struggle, you just need to close your eyes. And essentially, the storyline, the narrative is almost exactly the same. But then we are in this struggle together. So it's a great privilege and honor, really, to host you here. And we learned a great deal yesterday and today, this morning. And please, the floor is yours. And I would, you know, request you to kindly give us all the stories, all the experience that you have been through, and advice that we need to hear from you and learn from you. Thank you. With that note, please give warm welcome to Erkin.
Honorable Sikong, honorable Kalongs, and Rinpoches, and dear brothers and sisters, Tibetan, I always say, my Tibetan brothers and sisters, because you know, historically, those of you who have studied history, they will know that the Uyghur, especially the Uyghur Mongol and the Tibetans, throughout centuries they were united, and before embracing Islam, the Uyghurs in 10th century, they were Buddhists, and Islam did not spread so quickly. It took about 300 years before it spread all over Uzbekistan. And we have also the Khotanese people who are Buddhist, and normally actually they are Tibetan in origin, the Khotan people. So I said, Tashlek, we have similar words also. If you dig into the, maybe into the languages, you might have many similar words. For instance, we say "yaxshi tilek," and you say "tashi tilek," and that means "yaxshi" is good. And you say "tilek," we say "tilek." Tilek is wish. So, in one of the meetings in Washington, with organized Tibetans, Mongols, and Uyghurs, huge crowd, I tried to explain that. Suddenly, Mr. Tenzing Tetong said, Erkin, and we have Acha, you have Acha, sister. And I said, we have also, we call it Acha. And you say Sharqi Turkestan, use the word Sharqi. It's an Arabic word, actually. And so Sharqi Turkestan, some Tibetan friends, when they talk among each other, they say Sharqi Turkestan, for instance. When I said, well, sister, we have the same Acha, and Yakshe is good, and Dilek is wish. And Mr. Tenzing Tetong stood up and said, Erkin, Acha Yakshe, to me. Everybody laughed. So I said, and you have a good sister or something like that? So I have no elder sister, I have a younger sister, she's married, I said. So we have historically relations. What I wanted to keep into the day, I prepared a paper long years before. I will leave it here. Those of you who are interested, they might have a look at it, make a copy and have a look at it. What I wanted to say is, like you, we left 1949. I think a couple of years before, Tibet was invaded. Eastern Turkestan was invaded. And I and my father and the whole parents, about 1,850 people, we crossed over the Karakoram and Himalayan mountains, ended up in India, in Kashmir, Srinagar. And my sister passed away there, and she's buried in Srinagar, Kashmir. And Srinagar is somehow, I lived there 5 years, but that 5 years is equal to the 10 years I lived in Turkey and 5 years in the United States, and spent about my life about 24 different countries working as a journalist in my life. So I keep coming and all the time and visit, Kashmir very often. I have still friends there with whom I have contact for the last 60 years. This trip was that I talked so much about India, Kashmir and all that. 2007, I brought my son to see this country and visit Kashmir and all that. Now, he was very eager to do his internship in India somewhere. And luckily, we found Indian Parliamentary Research Center. He was admitted there to about 6 weeks internship. So he's doing the internship there. I am here with you. But being here, I promised His Holiness in Hamburg. I said, Your Holiness, last year when His Holiness was in Hamburg, and I will come to visit you. So I came as a private person. I am not representing any organization, because I am too old to hold any office, and since 2006 I am a free man. But until my resignation, let me go to India. In Srinagar we lived 5 years, and at that time Chinese were getting very aggressive, and Panditji asked my father, said whether you would be able to find a third country. So my father traveled to the Middle East countries to find a permanent residence for the Uyghurs that was immigrated from Eastern Turkestan. He was in several countries, but Turkey was the only country who gave us immediate refuge, because we are ethnically related to Turkey and other Turkic peoples of Central Asia, like Kazakh, Kyrgyz, Uzbek, Tatar, and so on. And so there are about 250 million Turkic-speaking peoples around the world. So we immigrated to Turkey. I went to school there. And then my father established his organization and started lobbying for the cause, especially in the Islamic world. First, he wanted to introduce his cause, first of all, to the Islamic world. And then, as of 1970s, he started traveling around the world to popularize his cause. In 1960, my father was attending the Afro-Asian conference in Delhi. And at that time, His Holiness came and settled in Mysore.
Masuri.
And my father and our former vice governor of Xinjiang provincial government, or Eastern Turkestan provincial government, went to visit His Holiness in 1960. Since then, There has always been a contact between the Uyghurs and the the Tibetan brothers and sisters. And then my father came 1970 to visit Holiness, and it was the first time in the history that His Holiness went out to visit somebody in Turkey that was my father. He took the trouble to go to Turkey to visit my father, and so on. The idea slowly and gradually was born that the Uyghurs, while we share the same, fate under being under Chinese rule, we decided at that time to establish an organization and work jointly together. So that's how the idea of Allied Committee was born. In 1984, we were all invited to Dharamsala to attend a seminar with special reference to Tibet. At that seminar meeting, we decided to set up an organization called Allied Committee of the Peoples of Eastern Eastern Tibet and Inner Mongolia. We started to give out, I'm sorry, I take a lot of medicine so my throat gets dry. And then, through that organization, we started to stage a huge propaganda throughout the world, organizing conferences, giving out brochures and bulletins and so on and so forth. And the late P.T. Takla played a major role in the establishment of that organization at that time. And I would like to mention that here. And he was a very sincere friend of ours also. He spoke fluent Chinese. My father spoke also very fluent Chinese. So they always communicated, being a mediator between His Holiness and my father. So, and then in 1991, Tibetans, Uyghurs, and some other nations around the world, during a conference in London, we have decided to set up the Unrepresented Nations and Peoples Organization, and we were the father of the idea of that organization, Tibetans and the Uyghurs. And that time we had about 75 members throughout the world, and now it's getting a little bit smaller, but still functioning, helping, assisting peoples all over the world, those who cannot. It is a platform to voice their grievances for many nations who are not represented in the United Nations. As you may know, there are 7,500 nations and peoples and minorities around the world, but the UN only less than 200 are represented. The other nations and peoples living and foreign in those countries, they cannot voice their grievances. So UNPO tried their best to do that. And then Daniela Mitterrand called me once, the first lady, former first lady of France, and she said, "Erkin, we're going to set up our organization in Barcelona called the Unity of Civil Societies. Would you like to join that?" I said, "Yes, we would certainly like to join that." And a huge meeting was arranged with the representative of about 45 civil societies around the world. In Barcelona, we set up the organization called Ubuntu. That means, in South African language, peace. So we organized that organization. And then 2004, Uyghurs were desperate to organize and set up an umbrella organization for themselves. And so we set up that organization, World Uyghur Congress, in 2004 in Munich. All organizations around the world, the Uyghur individual organizations, are affiliated with the World Uyghur Congress. So we have about 16 countries, Uyghur organizations. They are all under one umbrella now. After my resignation in 2006 because of health reasons, at that moment, Rabia Kadir came up, and we supported Rabia Kadir wholeheartedly, elected her because she was also a sensation. And so with the Western press, you know that it goes with sensation. If there's a sensation, a lot of papers and all that write about you, write about your plight, and so on. So I am retired since 2006, as I have said. So that is briefly my life if you want to know what I about my education background, my elementary school was in Eastern Turkestan. In Srinagar, I completed, used to call metric, I don't know whether it still exists, metric in Srinagar, Kashmir. And my Academy of Journalism, I studied in Turkey. And I went to United States to take some special courses. And then started to work as a journalist. And then in those years as a refugee kid, I had to work. Also, I joined the airlines because airlines business paid very well money at that time, salaries. And working there, the Americans discovered me. And they said, Erkin, why don't you work for Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty? So 10 years there and 35 years in Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty. And 99, I was retired actually. And 2001, after the 9/11, all comrades or friends, they called me up, colleagues, said, Erkin, would you like to do some freelance? So I said, okay, if I don't have to travel too long and, you know, too hardship, because they used to send me to places when the Soviets invaded Afghanistan. I was covering the stories there, and the Soviet helicopters flying over us, bombing all over. And in the Gulf War, I was there, and so I covered all several of these things. And besides all this, when I have some free time, we try to lobby. I call myself a lobbyist. I'm a professional lobbyist. If you need a lobbyist, please, Honorable Siko, you can always hire me. So some time to time, and I was trained also as a senior researcher. My title was senior research analyst. So I'm doing research work for some, what we call institutes around the world. So that's why short and brief life and my activities. But what I would like is, I see young faces here. And now my main thing was always, you know, hand over to the young people. They should take responsibility and start working and carrying the cause to the next generation. Last time I was in Munich, they said we were going to hold the meeting of the Eastern Turkestan Union in Europe. That was the first organization we set up in Europe. And my fathers, they were the first generation, I'm the second generation. Third generation was moving around, now the third generation. I said, now Eastern Turkestan Union in Europe should be handed over to the fourth generation. They should be all young people, not older than 30 years old. So they are all now young people. So when I see young people, I see the future of our cause. And you see, human beings are, what do we say? Causes are eternal, human beings are, can pass away anytime. So we have to you know, eternalize our cause. And that is the main thing for me. That's what I see, happy with the Uyghurs, that young generations have taken over, and I see young faces being here, interested to see an old man speaking, and that is very good. Thank you. Should you have any questions? I like, you know, questions and answers. That's much easier than speaking blah blah all the time.
Thank you very much for your very rich life experience. As you just heard, Erkin's family is very prominent in the Uyghur community. His late father was the Secretary General or the Premier or the Prime Minister of Xinjiang province. And then throughout his life, you told me that he went to the Middle East, and Kazakhstan has about a million Uyghur population.
That's true. Yeah.
And in Turkey, according to their estimate, 25,000. But as per the recent leader in Turkey, they estimate about 250,000 or so.
We immediately grabbed to that. I said we have 250,000 Uyghurs in Turkey at the moment.
Now they go with the official version. And Uyghurs are scattered all over.
Yes.
And then, but yes, then somehow the Uyghur Congress, National Congress,
yes,
is the umbrella organization, and it has been leading the movement. and the sufferings that we are undergoing are very similar.
Yeah.
Now, I have a few questions. One, I think, you know, to hear the East Turkestan or Xinjiang was Buddhist from 2nd, 3rd century to 10th century.
Yeah.
Then when Islam came in the 10th century, it took 300 years to cover all of East Turkestan.
Yeah.
So it was very much a Buddhist country. And then the challenges that you face in exile, trying to organize all the Uyghur people into one. And he was just sharing that in Munich only there are two different organizations. So he said, we can't work like that. We have to unite as one unit. Now it functions as one unit. And then now under the Uyghur National Congress, all the organizations are under the umbrella. So hence he felt unity is very important and passing the torch to younger generations.
Yes.
Very important. Yeah. So that has been his main efforts, and to a large extent, you have succeeded.
Yeah.
Now, if you could share with us, how was it in, let's say, in 1970s, 60s and 70s, when the focus and the interest wasn't much there?
Yeah.
About the Tibetan cause or the Uyghur cause, it picked up in maybe 80s a little bit. And in 90s, I think it was perhaps the height of international awareness for causes. And since then, what has happened, actually? Yeah.
When I started working for the radios in 1970, there were only three Uyghurs in Munich, three families in the United States. There were no Uyghurs in the Western countries. The Uyghurs started to come after 1990s because of the revolts there, tumult there. Many Uyghurs had to flee their homeland and they started to come. After that, now, in the 1949, when we fled, about 600,000 Uyghurs fled to Kazakhstan, and there are 60,000 in Kyrgyzstan, and the 40,000 in Uzbekistan and all Central Asian republics. And Turkey, we estimated, as Honorable Sigong just said, 30,000 Uyghurs, but the Turkish Vice Prime Minister, Premier, is that there are 250,000, so you cannot talk against the Vice Premier. We said, okay, that's 250,000 Uyghurs. Unity was very important. That's what one of the reasons that we could not start was we didn't have enough Uyghurs there, and I was the only one who, during my free times, running around. When I met His Holiness first time in 79 in Zurich, I said, Your Holiness, we have a cause, you know that, but we have difficulty propagating it. We will publish all the materials. You have offices now all over, slowly, gradually building up. We don't have that possibilities. And His Holiness agreed that we sent the materials to various Tibetan representations, and when they distribute a Tibetan material, they will also distribute an Uyghur material. And we requested His Holiness, you say you raise the Tibetan issue. While you are raising that, would you be able to please raise the Uyghur issue also? So His Holiness was very kind and generous. He was issuing that one. So we worked like that. And the reasons for these organizations, that even we were very less, reason for that establishing the organization was through that organization, using that as a platform to voice our grievances, demands, and desires to the world. That's how we, and as of 90s, when the Uyghurs started to come, the idea was born, now we have to set up an Uyghur umbrella organization, but how to do it? The problem is, we have about 40,000 Uyghurs living in Saudi Arabia. Now, their ideology is quite different than mine in Europe. There are Uyghurs living in Central Asia. they were more influenced by Marxist-Leninist ideas, socialism and all that ideas. So in Turkey, more Turkish nationalism ideas. But then how to bring all these mentalities under one umbrella? After long thinking, we said we have to have a call, first invite all the Uyghurs, representatives from all our regions, try to draft a resolution or draft a statute. And then according, let's go. So what we came as we all put on our ideas in there and slowly and gradually worked out a paper agreeing on the main principles which would not go against the interests of the Uyghurs living in Saudi Arabia, Turkey, Central Asian Republics, and Western Hemisphere. So when we completed that, and then we called a huge assembly. This was a very difficult, it took 1 or 2 years at least to work out that, because in the bulk of the Tibetans living in India, that was not the case with us. We were all scattered all over the world, and then Tibetans were lucky to have a leader like such as His Holiness the Dalai Lama. We don't have such a leader, and who would uniting forces. Even my father struggled, as we don't have that. You see, pyramid system, we had to choose, elect most of the time. That's how we did, as we have, as you have elected Sikong, Honorable Sikong now. So that was our system. Uyghur tribal system. Uyghurs are made of 21 tribes. And 21 tribes had its sub-tribes. The sub-tribes elected the tribal leader, and then the 21 tribal leaders came together to build the Qurultai, Majlis, or parliament. So, and then 21 people elected among themselves the leader, Khagan we call it, or Khagan. So that was the system. Ilvan Toynbee, if you read Toynbee, he describes the democratic system above the Turkic peoples. It goes back to about 6-7 centuries. So electing as well. So this procedure existed. So even today we have that system. So now we have all of our leaders. Which one is the most suitable leader? So they all came together. And in Saudi Arabia, in 1956, all leaders came together. They elected two people. One, my father, and Muhammad Emin Bora, the vice, in the 1940s, he was the vice president, vice governor of Eastern Turkestan government. So that is the system. After that finished, okay, and now, after his passing away, what to do? Now we don't have that leaders anymore, all possibly aged. So we found a way to invite everybody to Munich and to elect a new leader, but elected new leader, not forever, but for every 2 years. We should have a Congress, and every 2 years we elect a new president. But if he wants to run for second term, third term, it depends on the delegates. They have to say yes or no. So that was the system we have, and thank God we have managed to do that with all Uyghurs with different ideologies all over the world. So we came under an umbrella.
Before I invite the questions from audiences on this, if you could say what are the tactics, the strategy, cunning or not quite brutal ones that the Chinese government use against Uyghurs outside and inside?
I have learned one thing. One, in the late 70s, I ran into a French professor. I forgot his name now. I talked and talked and he said, look, Do you know what is the most influential weapon today? I said, atom bomb, this bomb, that bomb, didn't work. I said, no. You have to know the skills, how you have to convince the people. Convince the people. And then, if you're doing your lobby work in the West, we are all, you should not take, they are all Christians, they are all Westerns. No. You have to learn what a German think, what their mentality is, what they like and why don't they like. You have to learn the skills of mentalities of these, all these Europeans. We are not one. We have been centuries fighting with one another, he said. You know, it ended up with Second World War. We still have competition. So you have to learn the mentality of these people. To, you know, if you want to sell something, you cannot shake it. And you have to know the, we say zelk. I don't know what that means in English. Taste of Germans. What they like, what they don't like. And then, accordingly, you can sell your cause. Otherwise, you will not be success. And that's what we have to learn. And that's what I have been preaching my young brothers, the same thing. So you have to learn these skills. And thirdly, you have to learn the skills of, if you they throw you out from the door, you have to climb in from the window. If you don't do that, if you're, you know, there is no friendship. There's only national interests. National interests. If a major country is interested in my cause, I have to ask myself why he is interested. So, now, if that goes along with my own, it serves my interests. If that serves my interests, my enemy is my friend. We have to learn that. If somebody, you know, is a little bit unfriendly to us, we should not be emotional. We should be like the, you know, we should also learn the skills of, you know, to say there's no friendship, there's only national interest. We have to look after these certain things. So I try to be like that, you know, they throw me out from the door, I came in the first creep in from the window, and so can I, you know, these kind of tactics. Young people now doing that, Uyghurs are doing that now, the young generation.
The Chinese strategy towards Uyghurs, yes.
We have to bear in mind one thing. We are saying about, we talk about a lot about human rights, this and that and all that. We should not forget one thing. China has a very ancient policy. Da Hanzhuyi, create a great Chinese nation. This has for the 2,000 years continuously continued against their neighbors. Now, yesterday we discussed the Honorable Sikong and some of Kalon brothers. Imagine the Great Wall, that is the national border of China. Now they are 2,000 kilometers away from their national China. All these peoples slowly and gradually were assimilated. Even the Manchus were assimilated. Even the Mongols were assimilated in that country. Today the Mongolians is at what we call 5 million Mongols, they say, Inner Mongolia. 1 million Mongol can speak their mother tongue. The others are all gone. Gone. So they are struggling to free themselves and join Outer Mongolia, they say. They want to do that. Da Hanzhuyi policy has been applied by time of Kuomintang and now by the Manchu rule. They, Chinese scholars, influencing the one they have, what do we call, the Manchus were foreign powers actually, but at the end of their rule, they were all assimilated Manchus, assimilated by the Chinese culture. So now the Kuomintang policy was the same. They had a very famous professor Li Dongfang. He openly writes, He says, the Huns, as you may know in India, Hunas, the Huns are ethnically related to the Chinese. Uyghurs are the grandchildren of the Hunas, so we have blood relationship with the Uyghurs, they claimed. And our scholars came up with evidences that it's not true. Their old culture or language or had nothing to do with the Chinese and culture, the struggling. Now, the aim is slowly but gradually assimilating the Uyghurs. Young Uyghur children, not hundreds, thousands are taken into central China to give them education. And then they say, well, there's an unemployment problem among the Uyghurs in Xinjiang, so we have enough work in China. They're taking thousands of Uyghurs to China to make them work there, but treat them like as slaves. But the aim is to gradually assimilate them there. Now, schools, all schools are Uyghur teaching in Eastern Turkestan totally forbidden now. There's no Uyghur language schools at all. All instructions are in Chinese. Uyghur teachers who were not able to speak one word Chinese were forced to teach in Chinese. When they could not, they threw them out and brought Chinese teachers in the country. Now, and then, what is the most important shield against assimilation is religion, belief. Why did they attack the Buddhism? Why did they attack Islam under different cloaks? Unless they break up the religion in Eastern Turkestan, the religious belief, destroy the religious belief in Eastern Turkestan, they cannot assimilate. That's a third thing that are going on. So one of the main problems, and then the population transfer, in my time, it's still going on. My time, it's only 3% of the population were Chinese. And nowadays, it is, according to their statistics, they are about 46-47%, they say, Uyghurs, and almost 40-42% are Chinese, they claim. But it's other way around. Chinese have overpopulated the Uyghurs at the moment. That's the problem. And that's why we have a proverb, yat ölgünce at öl. Instead of dying in a bed, I'm going to die anyway by through an assimilation process. So why don't I stand up and die like a hero instead of dying in bed like a coward? This is the mentality Chinese policy had brought the Uyghur into such a position. They are revolting all over at the moment, all over. It is sad, it is bad. We preach nonviolence here and abroad, at home, because as a result of China's policy, the Uyghurs in their frustration, they are now on what we call a warpath with the Chinese, whatever they get. So that is the situation going on every day. Now, what could happen? In Eastern Turkestan, according to Chinese scholars, they say, if in Eastern Turkestan a major revolt breaks out, because the Uyghurs are Muslims, like in the case of Afghanistan, like in the case of Mali, Libya, Syria, Iraq, many Muslims, mujahideens, or international terrorists can come and what we call come to assist the Uyghurs to fight against Chinese. So, and then they say, Uyghurs are related to the peoples of Central Asia. If a major uprising breaks out, like in the 30s and 40s, it happened in 1930s and 30s, tens of thousands of Uyghurs, Kazakh, Kyrgyz, Uzbek, they came to Eastern Turkestan to help their brothers on the other side of the border. That could happen. When I go to Central Asian republics, they say, Erkin, we have a problem. I said, yes. If something like that happens, without our will, against our will, we will be in a terrible conflict with China. I said, yeah, that could be. That could be. And the best way is you have good friendly relations with China. Why don't you tell them to change their policy in Uzbekistan? Start a dialogue, you know, with the Chinese to pacify the Uyghurs for the time being. You know. And it is not, if in Eastern Turkestan something happens like that, because the terrorism in Pakistan and Afghanistan is already influencing the people there at that moment. And Central Asia, I'm afraid in such a case, it could spread into Tibet, Mongolia. They are, I have several examples at home. 1 year in Tibet, second year in Eastern Turkestan, revolts broke out. You may know that, some of you. You know, it happened very often that it influenced each other at that moment. So China's policies at the moment, unfortunately, is not pacifying the situation, but unfortunately, like throwing gas into a fire or something like that.
Yes. Now we'll have questions from the audience, so feel free to ask.
Thank you very much, sir, for your presence here. I have two questions. First one is the historical part, which is very interesting for me. You said about the linguistic similarity between Tibetans and the Uyghurs, the Yakshi Dele, mm-hmm. which is not more Tibetan to me than the Takshi Dele itself. Yakshi means like the best or the
best.
Good.
Yeah.
And what do you think is the, could it be a Tibetan language spoken by Uyghurs or a Uyghur language spoken Tibetan? That's the short question. And another question is, because here in exile we talk a lot about the violence, if we Tibetans take violent resistance against Chinese government, the world might not support us. Since there's, because of Chinese repression in Uyghur, there's violent resistance. So how do you feel, how do you get, what is the international reaction to the Uyghurs, how much support you get when there's violent resistance?
To the first question, of course, historically, Eastern Turkestan was on the Silk Road. Many cultures, languages, they came in our, and we should not forget the fact that Tibetan, during the time of King Trisan Detsen, they ruled Eastern Turkestan for 70 years. So we don't forget that also. So, during these periods, there must have been a lot of intermarriages, exchange of culture, language. Well, in my humble paper, there are some indications for that. I might give you a copy.
Khotanese, yeah.
And then you should not forget that the Khotanese people originally is Tibetan people. Mr. P.T. Takla wrote a very good article on that. And when I, my Khotanese friends, they are Uyghurs, I mean, today.
They're almost half a million.
And when we meet to go to meet His Holiness, when His Holiness is in Europe, my Khotanese friends, countrymen say, Your Holiness, I am from Khotan. And to impress His Holiness that his origin is Tibetan. And I said, Your Holiness, you see, Uyghurs are very generous. Although they are Tibetan in origin, we accept them and we treat them very well in our country. So, you know. And you should not forget that there are 5,000 to 6,000 Tibetans live in East Turkestan, especially in Yarkent, Khotan, and Kashgar areas. Tibetans live there, trade and all that. They have their shops and everything. There are about 600 to 700 Uyghurs, they are in Lhasa doing business. His Holiness told me once, he said, you know what, when the Tibetans went out to demonstrate, thank you, the Uyghurs closed down their shops and joined the Tibetans for the demonstration. And I will tell you, think that I'm a witness myself. Whenever Uyghurs meet Chinese, they kick him, or the Chinese kick Uyghurs, and Uyghurs kick there, and they, you know, always there are skirmishes there. When I visited Eastern Turkestan after 30 years of exile, in Kashgar, I was going along with my cousins, and on the street, 2-3 Uyghurs were walking, and some people were coming from the other side. the Uyghurs celebrate. You went and knocked them down. And the man there lying on the ground said, hey, what's a Shijangren? What's a Shijangren? And the Uyghurs went there, sorry. I saw that myself. And then for my cousin, I took a picture of His Holiness and gave it to him. And he hung in his room, guest room. There's a nice picture of 1960 taken by His Holiness and our two Uyghur leaders, where my father, I still have that picture. I gave a copy to him. One day he said they had a relationship with Tibetans in Kashgar. Some Tibetans came to visit his home. And they looked at the picture and stood up and went near and near and near. So, this is His Holiness Dalai Lama. And my cousin said, yes, this is my uncle, and this is his friend, and in the middle, this is His Holiness. And the Tibetans lay on the floor. I'm sorry, I get emotional. And they prayed there, and they said, secretly gave a picture. Can you give me a copy? And the secretly they made a copy, gave to the Tibetans. It was distributed among the Tibetans there in Uzbekistan. So,
if I may, actually one saying is that during the Cultural Revolution, or before Cultural Revolution, as per Pinchin Rinpoche's the petition to Mao Zedong and Chao Enlai, he has described that 98% of the monasteries and nunneries in Tibet were destroyed before 1963. And there was further destruction during the Cultural Revolution. But then one aspect, after meeting many Uyghur friends, they told me that in East Turkestan or Xinjiang, 98% of the mosques were not destroyed. The Uyghurs defended the mosques, and then before the Cultural Revolution, after the Cultural Revolution, they did not destroy the mosques because the Uyghurs defended it, and as far as Tibet, it's the other way around.
Yes, it's partly true, because we have black on white evidence. 54,000 mosques were destroyed. Now, when we say mosque, we say jami, in our word, and masjid. Masjid is in like a Christian terminology, chapel and church. So churches, mosque, we say jami, it's big, and the masjid is small. 54,000 masjid and jami were destroyed in Eastern Turkestan. 56,000 religious personality were all arrested, sent to what do we call those camps, hard labor camps, and re-educated and then sent back. So today, when I went in 1940, they said, oh, Erkin, you know what, we have allowed new mosques to be built, but the Chinese tell me that, but the Uyghurs say they are allowing for we have about 15, 20 million Uyghurs. And these masjids can take over a couple of hundred people. And jamis can take about 1,000 or 2,000 people. So for 50 to 20 million Uyghurs, that's not enough. Only 14,000 have been allowed to build at that time, in those years. But the rest were somehow restored by the help of Islamic countries and Turkey. But the great majority were totally destroyed. I saw with my own eyes, and I took pictures of them, destroyed mosques. And today, building of new mosques is forbidden. Religious teaching for young people under the age of 18 is forbidden. And then in the Ramadan, official office holders are forbidden to fast in the month of Ramadan, and then they come, if they want to try whether he fasted or not, they bring food, and offered them in the office a Chinese, say, eat. And if he doesn't eat, they know that he's fasting, and they force him not to lose his job, and he's forced to eat that food alone. And ladies are not allowed to go to the mosques, because ladies always went to mosques in our homeland. Compared to Islamic world, the Uyghur and the Uyghur Muslims, men or women, they're totally different. In our history, we have about 6 or 7 women leaders, commanders fighting as the, if you go to Beijing and Qianlong, the armies, Manchu armies, when the husband died, he was commanding the armies, Jahangir Hoja. And when he fell, his wife took the sword and started, because she was brought up as a warrior, as a young kid, daughter, lady. They played a very, ladies have a different role, you know, compared to other Islamic countries, different traditions.
Any other question? Yeah.
Thank you. So, you stated in your speech that the UN did not recognize the Uyghurs and a few other, many other minorities. So, many organizations did talk about the Uyghurs in the Human Rights Council. So, would you suggest that future generations use the UN as a platform to put forward more solutions towards the problems the Uyghurs, Tibetan Mongols face?
Yeah, I mean, the Uyghurs, especially, I can talk on behalf of the Uyghurs. Uyghurs are doing since, let's say, 95, 96, more Uyghur youth emerged in the Western countries with Western education, speaking one or two foreign languages fluently, and they played a major role also bringing up the cause. And they are in the UN, and the Geneva Human Rights Commission, they are always there. And in the European Parliament, national parliaments in Europe, and in the US Congress, they have become really quite effective, not as much as maybe the Tibetan brothers and sisters, but they are very active nowadays. That's the thing. I'll tell you, add one thing to the UN, unrepresented nations were only members allowed, those who rejected terrorism and violence. So any organization, wherever they might come from, we did not admit them if they were violent and using for what do we call terrorist methods.
Your contribution to the mission in course deeply appreciated. I just want to ask, you spoke about one of the organizations in London, UNPO, which basically helped raise voice for the minorities. So can I know what is the greatest achievement or the biggest output of this organization since it's related to the minorities, including Tibetans and Uyghurs? That's the first question. And what is the organization planning new to achieve this goal? And, second question,
Yeah. Can
you tell me, how many Chinese have migrated to East Turkestan since 1949 till now?
Okay. Let me start with the last one. We had 300,000 Chinese before that. Now, officially, they say there are 7 or 8 million Chinese in Eastern Turkestan, but my countrymen believe that at least 20, 22 million Chinese have immigrated since then to Eastern Turkestan. They are, you know, paying a lot of money for the Chinese to immigrate to Eastern Turkestan, so that the Chinese are going there. To the UNPO, what did UNPO? UNPO is a platform for me, for you, for other nations to use it. Use it. But achievements, we went out to Caucasia and to conflict prevention. They played a major role in conflict prevention. And what do we call, wherever there was a conflict, as you may know, at the moment they are about internal, there's not state-to-state wars, but interstate conflicts are getting more and more. According to some statistics, there are 65 ethnic conflicts going on at the moment, around the world at the moment. So UNPO try with its limited resources to play a major role where his members are in what do we call, involved in conflict problems. One conflict was, I can give you a good example, we tried to solve the conflict between Nagas and Indian government, for instance. They are now at peace, peace treaty is signed, and they're going, I assume, quite well. I haven't heard any problems. Now, Rohingya is not a problem, member of UNPO, but UNPO is trying to solve that problem through the Burmese government and with other neighboring states, how to solve that problem, that the Rohingyas are not totally, destroyed in that country. These kind of things, UNPO works with member funds, you see. We don't have large funds, yes, certain foundations around the world have helped, assisted, but most of the time we are supporting with our own contributions. But still, it's a platform and it's good. Doing quite good work, I would say.
Sir, thank you for your time and your presence here today. You have been a long observer of the Tibetan struggle. So can you, an unbiased observer, can you please tell us certain opportunities that we might have missed as a struggle, as a Tibetan struggle in the past 3 decades? And what do you think will be our greatest challenge looking forward in the past decade, in the future decade or so? That's one question. And you eloquently spoke about being a lobbyist. So do you find it difficult to lobby your own struggle with the next generation of your own people?
Well, young people, I will tell you, doing much better than I am. You see my English. I speak about 5-6 languages, all half. How many Urdu zaban, Hindi zaban, Bulgaria? 5 saal Hindustan mein rahe hain, Urdu zaban bol gaya. Aba Hindi gana bahut acha. So, okay. I'm forgetting your questions.
What are the lost opportunities?
Lost opportunities.
And challenges ahead.
Lost opportunities, I don't see any lost opportunities. We did, Tibetan brother and sister, under the leadership of His Holiness, did whatever they could. You know, whatever they could. And you have to, you cannot row against the current. You have to go along with the current sometimes, and maybe you make a, what we call, stopover somewhere, make a little camp and all that, but you continue. But I cannot talk about it, but they did their best, the Tibetan brothers and sisters. Uyghurs, in their humble capacities, they tried their best. And now the young generation is doing much better, I would say. Much better. So I don't see any missed opportunities in that respect. And your second question was? Or?
Challenges in the future.
Challenges in the future.
What I would suggest, independent or not independent, Tibetan people at home will live forever together there. The reason for setting up the Allied Committee was to show the world, which is at the moment on each other's throats, that the Muslim Uyghurs can join forces with the Buddhist Tibetans and Mongols, organize, set up an organization, work together. That was an example. It also encountered that organization, the Chinese policy at home to set us against each other. You might have heard about the Chinese Muslims. Hui, they call it. We call it Tungan. They send hundreds of Tungans. Tungan, Muslims, they are Muslims, Uyghur are Muslims. They don't let Uyghurs into their mosque. They are a very chauvinist way of thinking of Muslims. They sent these Muslims there to create problems with the Buddhist Tibetans, to show the world that, look, they cannot get along with anybody. So the setting up of that organization encountered such propagandas. If our country or people lived in centuries as neighbors, and politically, militarily, economically, culturally worked together for centuries. At least, oh, we should give, be an example, the Tibetans and the Uyghurs and the Mongols, to our people at home, that look, we are also united here. United means, doesn't mean that we, you know, follow the same policy. Tibetans and individuals, they have their own policy. Uyghurs have their own national interests. But there should be times to show the world that we can culturally organize something. We can have, you know, in the past, we in Holland, here and there we did. Uyghur dancers, musicians, Tibetan musicians, Mongol musicians came in together. We should also try to tell the world that, look, we are culturally also working together abroad to give the message at home, we Tibetans and Uyghurs abroad are like brothers and sisters. At home, you should be also doing the same thing. So this is my greatest desire, that or the peace between your people and my people is really established, and they don't fall into the trap of the Chinese propaganda. That would be my message, I would say.
Thank you for sharing your wisdom and experience you have for the last so many years. And Mike, just out of curiosity, you said that initially you set up your base in Turkey in order to raise a grander support from the Islamic world. And how actually over these years, how hopeful you are actually now in this present time to get more support from the Islamic world? And what is the present, I mean, what is the present status of the support from these countries, and what is your actual future hope to get more support from the Islamic world?
Yeah, our base was, during my father's lifetime, it was in Turkey. After he passed away, we moved our movement to the Western countries. The reason is, Turkey is a developing country. And like many other Middle Eastern countries, they're all developing countries. So, not to get them into trouble with China, we do most of our work in the Western countries. So, we have organizations, there we are allowed more with cultural activities. Okay, there are demonstrations, this and that, and Turks support Uyghur cause a lot. I mean, maybe not the governments, but from in the parliament, there are a lot of supporters. And among the ministers, not officially, unofficially, there are a lot of support from that. But in the Islamic world, there has not been so much support for our cause, that's a fact. But support is very important. But as I a while ago said, God helps those who help themselves. We rely more on our own. And, you know, I try to read history, starting from the Roman Empire and this empire, coming to the Ottoman Empire. All empires lasted a couple of hundred years and they fell apart. There's no guarantee. The Soviet Union fell apart. Nobody believed Soviet Union would fall apart. It fell apart. Nobody can guarantee me that the China communist system will fall apart. If the communist system falls apart, then they are Falun Gong there, the democratic-minded Chinese there. How it would be, that's a problem. That's why I keep telling democratic people, they are also not united among themselves. It's good that we have contact with them, but it should be based on a policy. I said, look, democracy is based on four pillars. One of the main pillar is self-determination. If you do not include self-determination for all peoples within China, non-Chinese peoples in your programs, we could end up like in Yugoslavia on each other's throats. If you include that, you give the right to the people to decide whatever they want to when the time arises. So That is the main point that we should be worried about. In case fell apart, what are we going to do? How are we going to handle the situation? Russia was fell apart. Nobody was prepared. Nobody was prepared, and they suddenly broke up. And then everybody, it took about a couple of years until they developed their policies. Even the Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and Central Asian republics were hesitant to declare their independence when the Soviet Union was already, it did not exist. So we in radio, that was the, we broadcast, I said, why don't you guys declare your independence, you know? So we should be prepared, not too much about, I gave you an example yesterday, saying that many people are now running after us and saying that, hey, look, you have oil, gas, and all of that. How are we going to do that? They're helping me because in case Eastern Turkestan becomes an independent country, how they would benefit from my oil and gas? That's the problem.
Oil companies have been contacted, Mr. Erkin.
Yes, that is a fact.
Yeah.
I think we will end with one last question because of time. What is, you can shout. Yeah.
My question, I have two questions, and the first one is what is the strength of the Uyghur movement that sustain your movement or to move forward? And the second question is, can you please give some insight of one or two, three strength that we should learn from each other? Uyghur movement and Tibetan movement. Okay.
We discussed a little bit yesterday. Let me briefly try to explain you. Uyghurs never, they were conquered by the Manchu rulers of China, inherited by National Chinese, and now by the Communist Chinese. We think that is an illegal occupation of Eastern Turkestan. Because Eastern Turkestan was occupied by the Manchu rulers of China, and Manchus, before they occupied us, they occupied China. So China has no right to free themselves from the Manchus. Maybe they have the right, but they don't have the right to keep a territory which was invaded by their own invaders. That's one thing. Second thing is how long did it last? Because Uyghurs never, as they never, they might be, might have been, what do we call, under Chinese rule today, but they never surrendered their sovereignty. No Uyghur ever surrendered sovereignty and accept that rule. In heart, they don't accept that. So that is the dynamo of that struggle that it came all these years. There's no nation on this earth, a small nation of 15, 20 million, revolting against a major country for 400 times. And during that period, we threw out the Chinese for three times, established all sultanate, or in two independent Eastern Turkestan republics. But what happened is, Eastern Turkestan has a Western Turkestan. That Western Turkestan is occupied by Russia and Soviet Union. They invaded or and destroyed all independent states because we would have been a bad example for the people's Turkic brothers on the other side of the border. That's the reason we were between two giants. You know, we freed ourselves from the one and the other came and occupied us and surrendered us to the Chinese again. That's why we could not gain our independence, but the struggle the going on. Because when we see Turkestan from the Huanghe for the Yellow River banks under the Caspian Sea, that's all Turkestan. That's a huge territory. So Western and then, so that territory, the name Turkestan was also given by foreigners, not by us. If Western Turkestan is independent, why not Eastern Turkestan is the desire? Because we were one people, one territory, for centuries before Russia and the Manchu rulers of China conquered us. So that is the desire, sir.
So what is the strength, if I may add here, what is one thing that you that kept you going also, that the rigorous...
Belief and hope. Belief and hope. Never give up hope. And you guys, if you give up hope, the people will be totally hopeless. Totally hopeless. Never give up hope. Never. And that's why we Uyghurs never gave up their hope and the belief that one day, my Jewish friends admire me when I talk to them like that. They said, Erkin, you are Jewish. You like to sound like Jewish. I said, why? He said, like, we also never gave up our hope. They never gave up their hope. And every year in their celebrations, I said, next year we will celebrate Shabbat in Jerusalem. After 2,000 years, they have their homeland now. So you should never give up the idea that you will ever return to Tibet again. And you should, what we call, uphold your culture, your language, and that is very important, and your belief. That's very important.
So with that very profound wisdom and advice, we will end here. And once again, such an honor and privilege to receive an old true friend of His Holiness the Dalai Lama and the Tibetan people. You have trekked the long journey for all these years with us, and obviously given our situation, we will again, you know, journey forward till the day freedom will be restored in East Turkestan and in Tibet and in Inner Mongolia as well.
Yeah.
So till then, our journey will continue, and with hope and full belief that one day sun will rise in that part of the world will become reality. So with that note, on behalf of the younger generation, to the younger generation Uyghurs, we wish you all the best.
Thank you.
And to your son as well.
Thank
you. So it's very kind of you to visit us here in Dharamsala and share your thoughts. So with that, once again,
I would like to thank you. Thank you. I came here. I didn't expect all this. You know, I just came here to short visit and get away. But thank you for organizing the meeting and lunch yesterday and organizing this meeting.
Sunday lunch.
Yes, and, and I would like to thank the young people all here. I mean, elderly should not get mad at me because I'm only talking about the young people here. I mean, they are very precious for us. They are like treasures. So I would like to thank you all for coming, taking the trouble to come up here to listen to an old man. Thank you. Shall we have a picture?
Sure. Would they? You want to have some of the group?
Yeah.